How do you connect to nature?
Constantly.
After the snow melts.
Mentally, emotionally, visually. The smell after it rains.
Disconnected.
Nature Conservancy is important to me because
the world isn't just out of offices, the world isn't just in our workplaces.
It's that feeling when you spend 8 hours hiking up a mountain to get to the summit.
It's the moment of magic where you realize, oh, okay, this is why we need to protect nature, because of the feeling that you get.
It directly impacts the physical and emotional health of human beings.
It's more than just what's on the surface. There's a lot more that's underneath that really ties back to a lot of our culture and our traditions, our ability to enjoy that and to really connect. And it's one of those things, when it's gone, it's gone.
It can't be left for some future generation.
It's part of who we are, and if we lose that, we lose a part of ourselves.
Help us reach
1 million acres conserved in BC
by Earth Day 2020.
Conservation is in our nature.
Our nature.
Our nature.
Our nature.
How do you connect to nature? Hi, my name is Jade. I'm a volunteer for the Nature Conservancy of Canada. I would like to introduce you to Michael Kearns. He's going to be our guide for tonight's nature talk.
So Jade volunteers for us, usually on a couch at Gary Oak Preserve. What's your favorite thing to do when you go out there?
Plant wildflowers, but baby animals.
Well, thank you, Jade. Thanks for being with us tonight. We'll get started, but we'll see a little bit more of you a little bit later, okay? All right, thank you. Good evening. I am Michael Kearns, the Director of Development for the Nature Conservancy of Canada in British Columbia. I can't see you all, but I thank you for being here. So thanks for coming to this brand new facility. We're very excited to be able to help Oak Bay Secondary kick off their inaugural school season, and we're very happy to be able to use this space tonight. So a special thank you to everybody at Oak Bay that helped make this happen. So I'm going to be your MC tonight, and I think I get roped into doing this because my initials happen to be MC. That's how it works. Thanks to those of you that laugh. I tell that joke every year. So my role as Director of Development is coordinating the funds that we need to achieve conservation success in BC. And that's what our partnership with each of you, that's when it becomes so very important. We're here tonight to talk about a number of interesting conservation topics. We're also here to talk to you about our brand new initiative, which is to help us reach 1 million acres that we've protected in British Columbia by Earth Day 2020. So you saw in the introductory slide here that we're 968,000 some acres along the way to that million acres. So we've set a target to hit that million acres by Earth Day 2020, but we'd really like to surpass it and keep going. So with your help, we can get there. We've got a couple of silent auction items tonight. You passed them on the way in, so please visit that table. We'll have a 10-minute stretch here in just a little bit after a couple of speakers, and we'll get the evening started with our first speaker, who is one of our biologists, our staff biologist. She works in the Southern Interior Project, Southern Interior Program area out of the Penticton area. So if you can imagine from the Soyuz area, from the Canada-US border all the way up past Kelowna, Barb is in charge of that particular area, program area. And she's going to talk to us tonight about that particular landscape. She is going to take the audience on a virtual tour of our Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area, which is a brand new conservation complex of lands that we've been assembling in some of the most extraordinarily rare ecosystem in all of Canada. Barb will tell you about that, but it's just a real pleasure to introduce Barb Pryce.
He's right. I can't see anyone, but I can hear you, and I know you're here. Thank you, Michael. Well, welcome to the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area. As Michael said, I want to take you on a virtual tour of this amazing landscape. So as you can see, a Soyuz on the right side of the screen, the conservation area is west of a Soyuz and it lies on the Canada-US border. And one thing that we're very interested in is connectivity. When we're able to connect tracts of conserved land or protected areas, that's really exciting for us because in conservation, bigger is better. And so what we have been able to do through our land assembly is to connect, in green you'll see sections of the South Okanagan Grasslands Protected Area. So the Nature Conservancy of Canada worked with four separate landowners to achieve this conservation area. And they were actually four separate projects that came together to create this tract of land in the South Okanagan. So the first property I'm going to guide you through is called the Sagebrush Slopes. A colleague of mine questioned us when we named it that. She said, well, say that about 10 times real fast. It's named for the sagebrush plant that grows there, as you can see, and it's one of the largest expanses of sagebrush in the southern interior. As you can see, it does go on for what feels like forever and ever when you're out there standing on this beautiful landscape. We are fortunate to have aspen copses there, and on the hilltops we have portions of dry Douglas fir forest there. Now, doesn't that just make you want to go there and run around and smell the sage and enjoy the breeze as it's blowing through your hair? Our next project was the Sparrow Grasslands, and that's actually Dick Canning's and I when we first acquired the lands, and we were out doing some surveys. And you know, it's a vast landscape. The people look pretty small when they're out there. We have at least seven species of sparrows on this property, and that's how many we've documented so far. And this is a beautiful picture in spring. You can see the balsam root in bloom. And again, we've got aspen copses, rugged terrain, which is really important for a vast array of species as well. And those mountains are actually in the United States, which is south of the conservation area. This is a view looking at a deep canyon that bisects the property. And we have, there's a spring down there, we've got some large cottonwood stands as well. And the river that you're looking at, which is south of the Nature Conservancy of Canada's lands, is the Similkameen River. Then we move on to South Block. And this was a very exciting project to do because it connected the sage portion and the sparrow portion that we had already acquired. We picked this one up in 2013. So again, a lovely spring picture. We've got, these are lupins, and again, you can see some of the dry forest that we're blessed with on the hilltops. This is a lake on South Block. I actually named it after a colleague of mine. We call it Andrew's Lake. And we see a lot of waterfall here, and that's really exciting as well. And this is a lovely fall picture, obviously, because the aspen is starting to turn golden. So now we move on to kit car, and I'll tell you why we've named it that in a minute. This is a really interesting property because we're experiencing more north-facing slopes on this particular property. And we've got a bit more of the dry forest, interior Douglas fir, which is one of the biogeoclimatic zones that occur on our conservation area. This is Kit Car Lake, and this is on the Kit Car property. It's about 10 acres in size. And as you can imagine, in this extremely arid landscape, water is an absolutely critical resource on the landscape. Now this is the original homestead for whom Kit Car is named. His name was Christopher Donahue Carr, C.D. Carr, but they called him Kit. And this is the home that he built there when he arrived in Canada from England at the turn of the century. And the reason we kept the name is because that's what people call it locally. If, you know, they say, oh yeah, up at Kit Car, you know, there's something happening up there. We wanted to honor that legacy and, you know, stay true to how the local people called it. So I want to share with you some of the amazing creatures that we have on our properties. To date, we've done intensive inventories. We've had a lot of experts on the property. They were dying to get out there. In fact, it was like Grand Central Station the first couple of years because people had not been welcome there to do scientific work when it was prior to it being owned by the Nature Conservancy of Canada. So we've had a lot of intensive inventories, and to date we've found about 52 species that are listed either federally or provincially. And by that number, we think it's one of the most diverse properties that we have in Canada in terms of listed species. That is the endangered sage thrasher, and we have some nesting pairs that are on the sagebrush slopes property. They're a small thrasher, and they need those large tracts of sagebrush for their life cycle. And they actually run through the brush foraging for insects. And they build their nests in the sagebrush plants, and sometimes they will build a shade platform over the nest to protect the eggs from the heat of the sun. Back. Don't you love technology? Okay. This is a threatened species. There it is. Cute. It's the common nighthawk. Unfortunately, it's not so common anymore. They're declining, and scientists think it's partly related to the general decline in insect populations. One cool thing about this bird is it lays two eggs directly on bare soil or sand, gravel, that kind of thing. And it's active primarily at dawn and dusk, so you don't see them often during the daytime. That's one of my favorite birds. Burrowing owls, they nest in abandoned underground burrows that are created by mammals such as badgers or coyotes. Ground squirrels, that kind of thing, marmots. On our South Block property, we have a burrowing owl reintroduction site. And it was there before NCC bought the land. And we're in partnership with the Burrowing Owl Society of British Columbia. And they maintain that site. And we're really excited to be working with them now to develop a new reintroduction site on our Sparrow Grassland property, excuse me. Because in my opinion, you can't have too many burrowing owls out there. Now this is a little butterfly that biologists said would not occur on the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area. It's named after the Half Moon Ranch in Wyoming, which is where it was first discovered. Apparently, it needs yarrow, which is what this particular butterfly is feeding on, and another plant called the parsnip-flowered buckwheat for its life cycle. These are nectar plants. And so the biologist I was with one day said, oh no, you're not going to find Half Moon hair streaks out here, because we don't have the buckwheat. So I'm just walking along, minding my own business, and all of a sudden I see buckwheat, and I see yarrow, and I'm thinking, isn't that the plant, the two plants that we're supposed to have in order to support the Half Moon hair streak? And then I looked a little further, and I see one of these, and I called him over, and I said, oh, isn't this Half Moon hair streak? And so there were about 20 there that day on that particular population site. And so he said he had to recalibrate his thinking because it wasn't expected to find them there. So we're very fortunate to have this endangered butterfly on our properties as well. Now this is the western harvest mouse, and it's a special concern, federally blue-listed in British Columbia. Believe it or not, it climbs shrubs and stalks of grass up to a meter high in order to find seeds, which it feeds on. Yeah, you're right. That's not a photograph. This is a shrew that is so rare in Canada, I could not find a picture of it on the internet. This shrew was discovered second occurrence only in Canada. There was some work done on our conservation area in 2013, I believe, and we were very fortunate to discover this little critter out there as well. So. Ooh. Yeah, we've got western rattlesnakes out there. They're threatened in Canada, and they're the only venomous snake that we have in British Columbia. Interesting to know, they have live births. They don't lay eggs. They bear their young live, as I said. And they share dens with other species of snakes, such as racers, garter snakes, and gopher snakes. And what's really cool about baby burrowing owls is that they make the sound of a rattlesnake when they feel threatened. You know, they're in their burrow, and if they're threatened by something approaching, a predator, they will make the sound of a rattlesnake in order to, you know, that's a defense mechanism that they have. Another little beauty, another favorite of mine, this is the North American racer. And they're stinking fast, I can tell you, because I've seen them, and they're gone almost in an eye, flash of an eye. And they're harmless to humans, just really pretty. Spadefoots. They're threatened in Canada, and they're one of our only dryland amphibians. And again, you know, one of the reasons that we treasure the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area, because of these amazing creatures. They stay underground for up to 8 months, and they only come out when conditions are right for them. They need warmer temperatures, they need wet soils to create the conditions for them to survive and breed. Their name comes from a spade, which is on each hind foot. and it helps them dig in the soil. And it's actually made of keratin, which is the same material that hair and nails are made from. So really cool little creatures as well. Into the plants. This is the Grand Coulee Owl Clover. It's covered entirely with little hairs. You can probably see some of them in this photograph. This plant is semi-parasitic, and so what it does is it connects its root system with other plants, and it obtains water and nutrients through that parasitic connection. The Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area has the largest of 5 known populations in the South Okanagan. So again, when that was discovered, we were pretty excited about that as well. Isn't that gorgeous? That lily was actually on the front of one of our arcs a number of years ago. There's only 5 populations of this particular plant that have been identified in British Columbia, and one of them is on the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area. It is a bulb plant, but it only reproduces by seed, and it falls through gravity to the ground. So it doesn't spread very fast. And I think that's why the populations are somewhat limited. Now this short-legged, powerful little creature is adapted to a life of digging. And I did mention a little bit earlier that abandoned badger burrows are often taken over by burrowing owls and rattlesnakes. And I'm not going to say anything more about the badger because Richard is going to talk to us about badgers in a bit more depth a little bit later in the program. This is a pallid bat, and we actually sponsored the BC Bat Team to do their bat blitz on our properties this past May. And so this was a net capture on the conservation area, and again, extremely rare animal. They fly very close to the ground to forage for prey, such as insects and scorpions. They eat scorpions, and so that's why they need to be close to the ground. The scorpions rarely venture out into the sunshine, but they do come out at night when they're subject to pallid bats coming by and snapping them up. Now this is a canyon bat. You can tell it's pretty small. This was discovered in the canyon I talked to you about on Sparrow Grasslands. We call that canyon Bat Canyon, after the canyon bat. It's the first record in Canada, so we don't know if they've always been there and they've just never been discovered. Is climate change pushing them north? They don't really come that far north into Washington State, so we need to do a little bit more research and inventory on this particular species. And they are tiny. They weigh as much as a Hershey Kiss. So, who would like to know what goes on at night on Kit Car when nobody's around? Everybody got their hands up? Here we go. So that was a bobcat and a cougar. We've installed some wildlife cameras on Kit Car this year, and these images were taken, I guess, in September. That's a close-up. You get up close and personal. They want a cameo in our slideshows. So, yeah, we call that Jimmy's Gate. That's right on the border, and of course this is good old-fashioned U.S. border security. right beside the gate is a cattle guard that used to be at that spot, and the cattle guard was pulled out. Jimmy put the gate in. This was after 9/11, if you can believe it. So you put your hand across there and your hand is actually in the United States. So that's it for me. I'm thrilled to see you here tonight. I hope you get to go out to the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area sometime and enjoy that beautiful landscape, and we welcome you to be there. So thank you for being here tonight. I appreciate it.
We've got another video here for you, just a real quick clip.
I connect to nature through a variety of different activities. I go camping, kayaking, trekking, and spend a lot of time in the outdoors, in the backcountry around this province.
My connection to nature was always more of a visual one. I'm not much an outdoorsy or camping guy necessarily, but I appreciate the environment that we have, and I think it's important to keep it.
I feel like when I spend time in nature, time stops. It allows me to touch base with myself, not only with my feelings, but also with a sense of calm. And then I get back into work on Monday much more invigorated and happier in general.
Nature has a huge impact on us, emotionally and psychologically even. It's not just physical health. I mean, I used to run on a treadmill, and one day I realized I was idiotic. I started running outside, and it just has a huge impact on your overall emotional well-being.
I grew up in the middle of Mexico City, so 25 million people, concrete, highways, freeways, cars, everywhere. When you live in an environment like that, you grow up in a place where you don't see nature, it becomes even more important for you to think about what nature does to your life, because when you do get a chance to go and experience nature, it's almost like it's a moment of magic where you realize, oh, okay, this is why we need to protect nature, because of the feeling that you get.
Sometimes people think of nature and conservancy in terms of like, saving the planet because there's some tree huggers or something. Without humans, the planet would flourish. And in fact, it's through nature that I think our longevity is intact. Because without nature, without these environments, without these complex ecosystems that support our survival, there's no future for humanity.
It's a survival strategy. Preserving nature is preserving ourselves. Nature is knowledge. An ecosystem is the maximum amount of knowledge that we have. Like, millions of years of evolution have led to the species that are in a particular place. So we need to preserve that knowledge and understand it, not only because of the interactions that it has between different species and ecosystems, but because, again, the interconnectedness of that nature allows all of us to be here.
So, since 1974, the Nature Conservancy of Canada has been very active in British Columbia. Our first project here was the protection of about 160 acres at Mud Bay, just south of Vancouver. And we've done about 104 conservation projects since. This past year, we pulled off what I'm told is a hat trick. I'm not much of a hockey fan, so I had to look that up. But that's when a player scores 3 goals in a single game. So, if NCC is the player, and the game was this calendar year, 2015, we did close on 3 properties in our 3 subregions across the province. So Barb talked about Kit Car in the Sage and Sparrow Conservation Area. That added 160 acres. We added Pine Butte. We added to our Pine Butte Ranch property in near Cranbrook. We acquired a property adjacent, which made that conservation project larger. And then up on the central coast, not far from Bella Bella, on Denny Island, we closed on a property called Gulchucks. And the Gulchucks River estuary there is just an amazing, amazing place for salmon. It was a piece of property that was on the real estate market that was brought to our attention. So we worked really quickly. An important estuary, an important spot for the Heiltsik First Nations, whom we work in very close partnership with. So that was the hat trick, three goals in a single game. But then we added this little island called Grace Island off of Ganges Harbor on Salt Spring Island. It's an island that's so small, about an eighth of an acre, that it's classified as an islet. This was, of course, in the news quite a bit. We have a number of folks here tonight that can speak to you about that if you have questions about that very interesting project. We worked very closely with the province. and also with the Cowichan tribes to find a better outcome for this particular piece of property. So that's kind of this year so far in a nutshell. But speaking of salmon, if I can go back to my Gulchuk's estuary, we do have our next speaker, Dr. Morgan Hocking, who is known as the Salmon Doc Hawk. No, Salmon Doc Hawk, is it right? I think I have the order wrong. Anyway, I'm not really good at nicknames. But Morgan's going to talk about his very, very exciting work with salmon and DNA and the forest. I think he's talking about all these things. So Dr. Morgan Hocking.
Thanks, Michael, and thanks very much for having me tonight, everybody. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah, so I've actually been to the Gulchuk watershed before that Michael was just talking about. So if anyone has any questions about that site, I'm not going to be talking about it tonight, but it's a very beautiful spot and has some really unique salmon runs. So yeah, feel free to ask me about that afterwards. But I'm going to talk tonight about just a few stories of salmon from our coastal rainforests in British Columbia. So freshwater ecosystems deliver key ecological functions and services to society. They're also some of the most threatened habitats on Earth and include many imperiled and extinct species. So science that can inform freshwater conservation but also considers the values that they bring to human societies is critical. So I've spent most of my career studying salmon, human ecosystems on the central coast of British Columbia. In particular, during their annual spawning migrations in the fall. Next slide. So I'm going to be talking about three different little stories from my research. Including the first being salmon forests, the importance of salmon to our coastal forest food webs, and in particular to plant biodiversity. My second little story is just a story of salmon management on the Quay watershed, which is also a location for NCC property. And the third is some of my new work at UVic with my graduate student Jeff McAdams, and we're looking at environmental DNA as a tool to monitor juvenile salmon in streams. So I was originally inspired to do this work by my PhD supervisor, Dr. Tom Reimken at the University of Victoria. And he spent many years in Haida Gwaii researching salmon and bears, and found that bears, by kind of hiding at night and with military glasses, that he found that bears actually feed a lot on salmon at night, and that they distribute the carcasses and nutrients into the forest. So this was a very inspiring research and led me to do my PhD with him. And this is just an old picture of me on the Central Coast with one of my health friends, Mike Windsor. And it was a different time back then. We basically drove out 2 hours from Bella Bella in this small little Zodiac with all of our stuff and camped for several weeks in these very remote watersheds in amongst the bears and wolves and salmon and wildlife. It was an incredible time. Next slide. This is roughly where we were on the Central Coast, and we're studying mainly two streams, the Clatsy and Nicus watersheds that have very high densities of spawning salmon. One of the first things we found was this number of salmon carcasses that were transferred to the forest by bears and other wildlife. The picture on the left actually is a wolf-killed salmon. That's very standard for their predation behavior. They typically consume the whole head and then leave the rest of the salmon behind. Whereas the carcass on the right is more of a bear-killed fish. It's a pink salmon. They typically consume the dorsal muscle, the belly, the brain, and often leave the rest of the fish behind as well. Next slide. Sometimes this nutrient transfer can occur in surprisingly high densities. This is just an example of a small stream where a wolf pack had come through, and this is both sides of the bank, and they had predated a large proportion of the salmon run and dropped them on the bank. So we're essentially asking, how does the salmon nutrients affect terrestrial biodiversity? A lot of my work as a PhD student was actually on insects and looking at the diverse food web associated with these salmon carcasses and how they're important for songbirds and other mammals. Next slide. This actually wasn't my favorite chapter of my thesis, but I did some experiments with salmon carcasses and trying to measure or quantify the number of fly larvae that are produced per carcass and then what that might mean for the energy subsidies to the watershed. But what I wanted to talk about today a bit was just how these subsidies of salmon nutrients can affect streamside plant communities. And next slide. To do that, I actually we scaled up this work. I went and did a postdoc at Simon Fraser University with Dr. John Reynolds. We scaled this work up to 50 or more streams on the Central Coast in the Great Barrier Rainforest, again working with the Helsinki Nation. We also counted salmon in these streams for several years. Sometimes we came across this crazy situation where we didn't know how to, you know, we're scratching our heads, how are we going to count all these fish? It's just incredible how many fish come back to some of these streams still. And then to this situation where some years we have very few fish and in some streams we have very few fish. So we have a broad gradient of streams that we're studying. To collect all the plant data, we went on this expedition to collect the plant data from 50 streams aboard this research vessel Achiever in summer of 2007. This is us just kind of on our practice day figuring out how we're going to identify all these plants. We laid down these, next slide, these 1 meter by 1 meter plots, and we in total laid down 1,200 of them in 50 different streams. And what did we find? Well, we did find that these salmon nutrients shift plant communities. This is my only figure in this talk, but essentially you can think of each of these points as a watershed average. And on the x-axis, this represents the number of salmon that come back to that watershed. So if you can imagine a watershed where that has 35 kilograms per meter of spawning length of salmon biomass for the whole length of the stream, that's a lot of salmon biomass, all the way down to zero. And on the y-axis, we have an axis of plant communities that I generated with kind of nutrient-poor azalea communities that dominate in low salmon conditions, and a shift towards, next slide, salmonberry in along streams where there's a lot of salmon. So just to go into that a little bit more, next slide. These nutrient-poor communities are dominated by a few species. Can anyone kind of name these species that are on here?
Azalea.
Salal.
Huckleberry.
Huckleberry.
Red huckleberry.
Red huckleberry.
Blueberry.
Blueberry, yeah.
Azalea.
And false azalea, yeah. Do you notice anything about what's similar about these species? Yes, they're all from the same family, plant family, Ericaceae. Yes. No, but go back. So the Ericaceae have these specialized adaptations in their roots. They have what are called ericoid mycorrhizae, a fungi, a symbiotic association that allows them to access nitrogen. And these are very common in kind of our zonal forests. Whereas, next slide. In the sort of high salmon density sites, we see a different plant community, a plant community that does well on nutrient-rich sites. And so we have salmonberry, also in the valley.
Devil's Club.
Devil's Club. Lady Fern. So these are all in different plant lineages. So one of the things that's just coming out, we just got a paper accepted in ecology, is that salmon are not only shifting plant communities, but then they're kind of releasing plants from this low nutrient stress, and it's increasing the lineage diversity of plants that live beside salmon streams. Next slide. So my next little story here is about working with communities. I've worked a lot with the Heltsuk community on the Central Coast. Next. And we're asking the question, how do you integrate human well-being and ecosystem values into salmon management? And it's a difficult question. Next. I worked for a few years with CUPS Project Society, a Heltsuk Nation nonprofit, who are working on a number of really cool projects. But one of them is to improve salmon management in their territory and to increase their connection to these salmon runs and increase local stewardship of these salmon runs. Next slide. One of the contexts in the region is that, of course, sockeye salmon are of very high importance, but sockeye salmon in the region have declined in recent years, prompting concerns from the local community. Next slide. So one of the places that we're working on this conservation is at the Kwai watershed on the Central Coast across from the Haka Institute. Has anyone been to the Kwai? Maybe a little shout out for those who have been to the Kwai.
Yeah.
This was a beautiful place. It's a grizzly bear sanctuary. It has all species of salmon. NCC has a property at the mouth. And we were interested in this because it has a sockeye run, and we were wanting to get up into the Kwai Lake to study the sockeye, because sockeye spawn in tributaries of lakes. This is a big watershed, so to get up there, just to, I think it's number 3 there at the little Kwai Lake, takes like a full day of hiking up there. This is some of the work that kind of intersected a few years ago with some of the work that NCC was doing at the Kwai. Next slide. Sort of long story short, we built a trail from the estuary up to Kwai Lake. So this is just a picture of us doing our kind of scouting mission and planning, mapping the trail. Next slide. This is our kind of map of the trail that we made and of the trail route. Next slide. And then this is us up there actually building the trail. It's quite an incredible mission. One of the times of my life. Next slide. Subsequent to that, a cabin was built up at the lake, and which enabled research on sockeye salmon up at the lake. Next slide. And we were able to, you know, drag our canoes and have like a safe base to study sockeye up at Kwai Lake. Next slide. As this was going on, and just after this was completed, CUCS Project Society initiated this really cool project where they built a traditional, and I was involved in this initially, where they built a traditional fish weir at the Kwai watershed. Next slide. It's a really cool project that integrates science with capacity building, bringing youth out, Celtic youth, to the weir. The idea is to perhaps do some harvesting, but most of it is a science project, and passing fish past the weir, passing the sockeye that are coming up in June, pass them past the weir, measure them, tag them, perhaps age them, and it's a way to understand their population diversity. Next slide. And then we go up into the upper watershed later on in the fall. We can track when individuals come in, where they go, their age structure, determine a population size and all these things. So it's a very cool way to kind of integrate capacity building and science. Next slide. So just to kind of sum this up, this little portion. I kind of feel like managing salmon for resilience, a really good way to do that is to integrate the local social and management system with knowledge of the population diversity of salmon. So you can really understand how many you can harvest and when, and so on. And I think NCC can be proud of their contribution that they've made at this point. Finally, just talk about some of my newest research. I'm working with my grad student, Jeff, at UVic. So traditional monitoring of, in particular, juvenile salmon is often invasive. It involves a lot of equipment, time and effort. In particular, up on the left, I'm showing electrofishing, which is a very common inventory technique for juvenile salmon in streams on our coast. And this involves actually shocking the fish in the stream, studying them and capturing them, and there's some associated mortality with that. And so we're trying to develop a new technique for monitoring juvenile salmon in streams, next slide, that uses environmental DNA collected from stream water. So there's my grad student up on the right, and this is a project through University of Victoria, the Center for Biomedical Research at UVic, the Goldstream Hatchery, and also the Hakai Institute. Next slide. Essentially what you do is you collect water from the stream, filter that water through a fine membrane. Next slide. Extract that DNA from the membrane. So this is just, you know, the DNA that's free floating in the water. And then you amplify that DNA with PCR, which targets specific species. So in this case, we're interested in targeting coho salmon, and then also more broadly, salmonid family. So just to show a little bit of results, this is our field setup for this project, the Hakai Institute on the Central Coast. And these are some of the sort of long-term monitoring watersheds that are part of that Hakai program. Next slide. So we've inventoried these watersheds using traditional methods. These are some of the fish species that are there. So we see coho salmon, for example, juveniles, coastal cutthroat trout. Next slide. Next. Right, so this shows from five different streams. Those numbers just represent different streams. Five different streams, what species we found using conventional detection methods. So in 844, we see no salmon, no salmonid, and no coho. 703, no coho, but cutthroat trout, so salmonid. 708 and 867, we see both. And then in 1015, we see again no coho, but salmonid, so cutthroat trout. Next slide. If we overlay that with our eDNA detection, so we're essentially taking, scooping water right from the mouth. Next. We see basically the exact same result, except up in 1015, we see potentially more precision. So we didn't see coevolution using traditional methods, but using eDNA we did. So perhaps, you know, we didn't set the trap in the right place or whatever at that particular time. Next slide. So we're also trying to expand this to analyses within watersheds, fish swim all over within watersheds, and so we're trying to track coho as they move through this one particular watershed, and this just shows that indeed they're all over the place in this one watershed. So just to kind of summarize that, we're keen on using this method as a potentially non-invasive way to identify salmon in streams, and sort of a rapid assessment and non-invasive way to assess salmon in streams. So, yeah, thank you. Those are my stories of salmon conservation on our coast.
Thank you, Morgan. I think we've got one quick video clip. I want to give a shout out to our techs in the light booth. We have Sophie from, she's a secondary student here at Hope Bay, who's volunteered tonight to help us with tech.
We've got Leslie, our communications manager. They're trying to navigate through the very complicated series of PowerPoints and videos. So do we have the video of Jay that you could play, Leslie? I thought we'd play Jay's video so she can go home and get to bed. It's a school night.
I connected the nature when I go camping. I see a lot of animals. I see bears, grasshoppers, and I see deers. And I love animals. I have fun in nature.
Take just a quick 10-minute break to stretch your legs and maybe visit the silent auction table and refill your coffees. But before we go, I just want to talk about these film clips that we're sharing with you this evening. And thank you, Jay, for being with us tonight. We wanted to launch our initiative to reach 1 million acres by Earth Day 2020 in a lot of different ways. And so we put our heads together and found out who our friends were and found out who our volunteer filmmaker friends might be that were working in the film industry. We got them together. They volunteered their time to put these clips together using interview material from some of our corporate leaders in British Columbia, but also taking Jade out with the film crew as well. We matched that up with some of the B-roll footage that we have from our properties, and so we created a number of these short little videos that will live on our website and will be used to help launch the initiative far and wide. So thanks to all of our volunteers that helped us with these film clips. So again, a 10-minute intermission. I just want to point out that we have all of the BC staff members in the room tonight. All 20 of us from across the province, 6 different offices are here this week doing some strategic planning and looking at the business year ahead. And so they're mostly all wearing white shirts with the Nature Conservancy of Canada logo on them. Probably talked to them before during the reception, but you can talk to them again. Ask any questions you like, and we'll come back here in 10 minutes. So thank you very much.